Baltimore, Maryland. He has worked in Jamaica, where he managed a bush clinic before returning to Elms to coordinate the second-degree nursing program. Brother Michael developed the Elms Caravan to serve Chickadees, homeless, and underserved populations. And tonight he will be speaking about God and others and serving God in the marketplace. So without further ado, please help me join in welcoming Brother Michael.
I promised Sister I would only read the first three chapters of the book that I brought out loud, so just to make it clear. I was asked to connect the idea of the Year of Mercy, something from Pope Francis's materials, and then how that relates to working with others, the dignity of a person. Rather than bore you with that, I would just go off the cuff. Francis, before becoming Pope, was a bishop in South America. And somewhere in the 90s, he was the principal pen behind a document that came out of South America, the Aparecida documents. And for those of us that lived in the West Indies and Jamaica, it kind of was the big thing. How would we evangelize and be available to peoples? Since becoming Pope, he's taken a lot of what he actually started way back in South America and has tried to operationalize that a little more worldwide. In fact, this book, though it bears his picture, are his writings from before he was a bishop, before he was Pope. And they speak to this year of mercy that we're in now. And I would make reference to his most recent talk, I'll cut the one out, when he was before Congress. If you recall back in 2015, he spoke before Congress, and he said that each of us in any country is given a mission, personal and social, and it is a responsibility, and that we have a vocation to satisfy the common need by stimulating the growth of all its members, but most especially those of greater vulnerability or risk. It was in that same speech that he went on to call out four people that I talked about a whole lot that no one expected me to talk about: Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King, Dorothy Day, and Thomas Merton. Saints of our day, in a way, and that was unusual. People didn't expect me to pick those. And here at Elms, I said, well, no better segue than to talk a little bit about Dorothy Day. How many Dorothy Dayers we have here today? Okay. So we know a little bit about Dorothy Day, now servant of God, on her way to be a saint. And in that Dorothy Day model, she talks about, and it's part of what I use as the theme for the bus, that is, if you put a pot of coffee out, or you put out a pot of soup, or just put them on the stove and you open the door, God will take care of the rest. So, a pot of coffee, open the door, and look who comes in. On Sunday, for an experiment, I didn't have coffee in the bus. We have it once a month when we do feed and we prepare to try to attract the crowd. The number of people that come by looking for the coffee, we have, you know, Gatorade, water, crackers, and regular things every week. But the idea of coming around that pot of coffee, the dignity of those who live on our streets in Chickadee. How many people live underneath the bridge, down by the dock, or by the sewer plant? Anybody want to take a stab? That's how many. Come on, somebody. Give me a face. You're a little high. We used to have 46, we're down in the 30s. Some of them moved, a couple died. But just recently, I had to write a prescription for somebody who needed antibiotics. And the pharmacist at Walmart, I put a woman the address on it, homeless. And he said, there are no people homeless in Chickadee. What do you mean he's homeless? I said, he lives under 391. He has an infection. I'm here to pick up medicine for him.
That's right, homeless.
I would be so this guy grilled me on the fact that he's our homeless. And I said, yes, he lives under the bridge. Now, I was hoping that in helping it out, he would come back and say, what? Well, he's free, so I'm leaving. I'm not going to be charging. I was hoping. that's the reality here. We have about, let's say, 33 and 36, depending on where you count. We have a lot of under-housed people. So when I did my study with that, since I gave this now, 11, I interviewed 46 people that live along the river. And so to kind of highlight the idea, one of the last questions for them to be included in my study was, do you consider yourself homeless? I had a really good interview with a guy, and I was really like, no, I come here for the social part. I come here because I live alone. I come here because I don't have anybody to eat dinner with. He's not homeless in the traditional sense, but he has no one. He has two dogs, which he's very fond of. He calls his kids. I ask him about them every week because our number one was the road bus. But his need wasn't for a house, it wasn't for a place to live, it was for a place to have dinner. And for those that are nursing babies, you know how important it is, the social piece of eating, coming together, coming here, coming to the cafeteria, rather than eating in the room. The dignity that he would have by having a conversation. He seeks us out every Sunday and every Tuesday. Does he have real need? He's a veteran. He's hooked up with services. He comes every faithful. If he doesn't show up, I get a little nervous. What's he saying? Something. He's got prostate problems. He's got some other issues going on. So where is he? At the same time, the idea of dignity. There was another man that I interviewed. We had a great interview. Got near the end and I said, well, are you homeless? And he said, no, I'm not homeless. Another one I got to bring up. He said, I'm in a tent. I live in a tent down by the river. I said, oh, I can't bring what you said. He stays in the sun. But I have a tent. And he proceeded to tell the story of he was one of those folks that in the crash of 2008-ish, he lost his job. To get a flock house, you need a month up front, the month you're there, and a month rent of security. He says, I'm living in the tent until I get 3 months rent saved. I got another small job now, and that's how I'm going to get back on my feet. We'll call him Steve. So Steve came regularly, talked to me, told me a lot about what was going on down by the river and how people were living. And he has worked himself out of the tent. He's got a flop house, a small place down at the west end here, down by the Fez. And he's not in the tent then. The second biggest concern was, probably don't think about it, was what we really need is a place in the winter to wash our clothes. Wash, usually find water, but they freeze before we can dry them. So the idea of housing, of clothing, of health care, what we can do with helping where these folks are. The theorist that I use, which I won't bore you with, talks about the idea that we can't always fix everything. We can ease it. We might be able to help them do something in the interim, or we might actually be able to have them transcend. I can't fix every person's housing need on the bus, but sometimes I can help them get a box, and I can sleep in that tonight. There's a group of ladies from Ludlow who make this wonderful bag of sleeping mats out of shopping bags so that there's something between them and the ground, which will ease where they sleep. And on a rare occasion, we can sometimes get them into Oregon Timber somewhere. So the dignity of folks is something that we're all called to do, something that we're called to respond to as baptized Christians, as people who believe in a God, whatever God that is. You know, how would God treat this person in this moment? That's the dignity of this. So the care van came about to be one of those things that we here at the Elms could do as an outreach here in Chicago. Healthcare, cut hair, clip toes, provide socks in the winter, things like that. Coffee and donuts. We have laundry day to respond in part to Steve's concern about where do we do our laundry. We give out laundry cards so they can go to a local wash at the laundromat down if you're familiar with the river center yet next to the Family Dollar. So Francis, in his writings, talks about how are we educating, how are we feeding, how are we housing, is there social justice, is there good education? They're the five domains. And if we look at what he's done in the years that he's been in office, anybody know what the first thing he did to upraise the dignity of the folks? Anybody know what he did? He's done two major things, similar to what I'm talking about. Anybody?
It's the homeless shower, it's
right. First of all, he told his allower, A-L-O-N-E-R, as if we all know what that is, the guy who gives out stuff at the door, okay, so to speak, that those who come to the door to be taken care of will have to be turned away. Anybody read in the past week or hear what Holyoke's doing? They finally want to a similar, they want to a voucher system. There's a voucher system in place for the homeless where rather than giving money or whatever, they can get a voucher for food, they can get a voucher for the laundromat, they can get a voucher for this or that. So he told his alumni, whoever comes to the door, give them what they need, feed them. And he immediately started work on a shower. Okay? The Vatican now has outside the walls, to the right-hand side under the portico, they have a shower for the homeless, which runs daily for their needs. How do you make real something that you talk about? We could read this, it'll be very boring, and we read it tonight during meditation to make sure I remembered all those parts, but it could be pretty dry. What does he do? He says, feed them, give them clothes, give them a place to take a shower. Elevate their dignity. I worked for 98 years at the Catholic Worker Free Clinic in Philadelphia. And that was our backbone of ours. Because if we come out of the Dorothy Day tradition, what's the mainstay of Dorothy Day's theology? Anybody? Begins with an H. Sister raised her hand, I'll go on prayer for that. The mainstay of Dorothy Day's theology is hospitality. Hospitality. And we ran 12 showers a day. We only had one, but we were open and we had a 10-minute bang on the door. The person came out, the next person got a towel, one of those hotel soaps, pair of socks, pair of underwear, 10 minutes, bang on the door. Okay? Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, every week. The clinic ran at the same time, but the mainstay, the backbone, and their original ministry was that of hospitality. Offering hospitality to folks that usually aren't offered hospitality. And my final. Most of us, in the very common, the idea of hospitality, how many times have you been asked, read out, shake it down for some change? The cardboard sign with I'm homeless, I'm hungry, I'm in bed. Okay? Let's take that to the next step with regards to dignity as part of this and the thought about this. These folks that are there, okay? There have been cities that have been that do that, etc. Twice in my life I've given money to someone begging. Anybody want to know the first person? I won't lie to you, his sign said, I want to be here, can you spend a buck? I gave him a dollar. Why? Who said it? Take him down. He's honest. He's honest. I'm not gonna lie to you. I want a beer. Can I have a buck? Yes, I will give you a buck. Tell me you're hungry. I'll go to McDonald's. I'll go to Burger King. I'll go to the dollar store. I'll buy a pound of bologna, a pound of cheese, and a loaf of bread. I'll give it to the guy begging out in front of the dollar store. But I will not give that to the dollar. That doesn't raise him up. The other was, her name was Pepe, and she was begging to the market in South America, and she was begging rather than working the streets, and I would give her a dollar and keep them off the streets. If it's going to raise their dignity, then I would give it to them, but I'm not going to give her that dollar. But I'm also not going to just walk away, because there is a human person, there's a God in them. I would say to them, as you're staring at me, I'll say, I don't have anything for you today. Make eye contact with me. I can have anything for you today. That doesn't preclude tomorrow or the next day. My eye contact is at the God-given right of staring me in the eye. And I'm not lying to them in the sense of what I'm putting off to the next day. So, as we move forward, how do we, as a church community, as a parish community, as a school community, as an Agape group, make that real in our dorm, in our classroom, in our students? Thank you for inviting me. I will take questions. Down, stop by and say hi.